Okay, so welcome to this presentation about Tableau at Creo. But first, who are we? So I'm François Hier. I'm in Creo R&D. I'm engineering manager for the data visualization and exploration group.
And I'm Damien, and I'm a software engineer in this team, actually.
Yeah. And the second question might be, who's Creo? And so the famous thing I like to say, so that's the nice marketing slide. So Gilles, you might like that. The first thing I like to say is that Creo is the biggest company you never heard of. Why is that? So we are in the ad tech business mostly, even if it's a written marketing ecosystem. We help brands and advertisers to drive commerce sales. But the main thing I want you to remember is not that, even if some people would like that, is that we have thousands of employees, we have thousands of clients. And of course, we have lots of data. So I don't want you to remember that either. There are a few interesting things. So we have the biggest Hadoop cluster in Europe. So we have petabytes of data. We drive trillions of transactions every day. And so we have data problems. Long story short, that was the only intent of those slides. This is mine, so this is less marketing. So we have a distributed data problem, if I may phrase that properly. So the thing is, Creo has many offices around the world because we have clients around the world. And so our clients, since our former motto was performance is everything, want to know how their campaigns are going. And to do that, what do? They send emails or they contact their local analysts. So we have lots of analysts around the world. So this is the number of countries, like we have hundreds of analysts in many countries. So we have lots of data, a distributed organization, many analysts in many countries. So how was it before we get even hired a few years ago? It's going to be a short story. So in any company, you would have done the usual way, like Gantt chart, project, 2 months, and all that stuff. And of course, that's not the way we were doing that. The way we were doing that is that we were asking all those guys in many organizations with not that much computer science background whatsoever to figure that out, basically. The infrastructure of Creo was made of sharded SQL servers, pretty much the same model that Facebook or Twitter had back in the days. So you had lots of databases. What I mean by lot is really lot, really, really a lot. So you have thousands of databases, and all the client data was spread among that. So an analyst that we were hiring in the regions was supposed to figure that out and build visualization on top of that, which led to that kind of code. We were using reporting services back in the days, and the guys were writing code like crazy. I mean, it worked. I mean, we had a gigantic reporting services server with ugly things like that, but it was mostly write-only code, and basically we had to hire geniuses to be able to do that. And the thing is, you don't scale geniuses. At some point, your company is facing growth, you need to hire more people, and you can't wait for them to be up to the point where we can do that. So we need to do something. And so that's where our team was basically built, to say, you need to first solve this data problem. You need to put all the data together so that people can access it, and then find a visualization layer for that. And this visualization layer was Tableau, no surprise. So we more or less did that before Damien joined us. So we were a Linux team. We more or less succeeded in setting up Tableau. That's another story, which is kind of funny, but I don't have much time. Long story short, a few years later, we do run Tableau on Linux, works perfectly fine. And not only the analyst, but the whole company is basically using Tableau, from finance, marketing, R&D. I use Tableau, even if I'm a Linux user. I do own a Windows just to do Tableau, and PowerPoint maybe. So everyone is using Tableau, and at first everybody loved that. So those are fake emails that I received, but I really received tons of emails saying, thank you for Tableau, this was so great, the reports are fast, and blah, blah, blah. Until it got slow. So I get, you all got that, like this point where Tableau is slow. So when Tableau is slow, I mean, the nice emails just become hate mails. The hate mails turn to hate phone calls from my boss on bank holidays, and I'm French, bank holidays do matter for us. And why is that? Why is that? There's no real surprise there. I mean, we basically did the same mistake we did with reporting services. We just let a server to everyone, put as much as you want inside that, get all the data you want, so you end up with hundreds, if not thousands, of dashboards, no owners. Some of them don't work. Some of them don't even show the same data. And so what do you do? So here again, you have two options. we can decide, okay, we're going to lock Tableau server, and we're going to say we're going to hire a team of specialists, and they're going to do the reports. And it's finished. But it's not the way we decided to go. Instead, we thought that we needed something else. So the idea was to say, okay, we need to trust those guys. They're in the regions. We can't be there to help them. The only way we need a way to be able to check that what they're doing is good. And so hence the trust but verify, which is a quote from Lenin or Ronald Reagan. Pick the one you prefer. That's the same quote. And that's where we ended up with this, what we call at some point, red pill for Tableau. So in R&D in 2014, we had pretty much the same issue, but with code. We lacked some test coverage, we lacked some proper deployment tools and monitoring tools, and so our CTO basically came to the entire R&D team and saying, okay guys, so right now we need to stop delivering feature, we need to stop and work on tooling, work on testing, and that's a red pill to swallow. But once you swallow this red pill and you work for a few months doing that, you're gonna see, after that, it's gonna be great. And so we decided to basically swallow the red pill on R&D side, and we said, we're gonna make those guys on the business side swallow the red pill. We don't call that red pill, we call that top for Tableau release process. And Damien's gonna tell you everything about that.
So we didn't want to have a centralized control because we couldn't scale it. It would be the same thing as having a team doing the reports. If only a team is checking all the reports, it wouldn't scale to a situation, especially with all these local people working around. So the main principle we wanted TARP to do is to have a peer review system. So any content that goes to production has to be checked by another analyst to make sure that the calculations are right, the performance is okay, and that it's ready for being shared to everyone. So this is the trust part, I guess. The second part is actually the verify. So what we do is actually we implemented some technical and best practices check that we are going to do before the content can move forward. It's actually very important because we do everything with the REST API, so the Tableau Server REST API, and there are a few corner cases that doesn't really work with Extract in particular, so we want to filter that out before so we don't actually block a release when it has to happen. The next point, and I think this is something that people were really worrying about because you say, okay, you're taking back agility from us, so we are not going to be able to release, so we have a release every 3 weeks or something, and we say, no, you won't be able to release as of today, like release whenever you want indirectly into production, but you'll have scheduled release every day.
So yeah, the main idea is to have predictable releases, yeah.
Yeah, so it's very predictable for them. Every day they are going to be able to release something as long as it has been validated before. The other key elements, and this is more on the scaling of the platform, is to be able to manage a multi-environment. So at that time, we had only one Vertica cluster to manage everything. And yeah, a lot of the slowness was actually coming from the backend database. So we decided to have two Vertica clusters, very smart people. So one for ad hoc and development, so Tableau desktop queries, for example, and the other one dedicated to Tableau server. So yeah, our solution has to be able to switch between them.
But the main point to that is that you most likely don't need to do that. Like, I mean, there's a disclaimer I forgot to say, but in this company we have insane problems. Like, this is not an advice, like, that's an idea. Don't do that if you don't need to. Like, manage two clusters is like a silly idea if you do that only if you need to. That's just me.
It's very specific to us for that part. The next thing we wanted is versioning. So at that time we started with Tableau 9 something. Versioning was not really a thing in Tableau server. We are developers, so we say, okay, we are just going to put everything in Git. So now all our workbooks and their contents, so pictures, CSV files, if any, are actually stored in Git. And the last point is easy to use because, yeah, they have this nice Tableau desktop UI, so we should obviously provide something that is as good. So in the end, it's so-so. It's a command line tool. So the UX, we are not UX developer, we are not Tableau, so unfortunately we didn't reach that point. So to be fair, this is not the worst thing that we have at Crito for them. So it's kind of good. Good enough for them. So I won't show you the command line tool. I'll just show you what the process looks like. So we have an analyst, so he wants to develop a new report, so he just does that on Tableau desktop. Then instead of publishing that to production, he will just publish that to Git. So we actually use Gerrit. Gerrit is actually a Git with an ugly UI to do validation. So this is a peer review. It just allows them to flag that they have validated something.
And if you don't know what Git is, Git is basically a version file system that us developers use to do peer reviews, to be able to keep history of files and stuff like that. But it's just that.
Yeah.
I saw people looking at me like, what's this Git thing?
Yeah. So its version is nice. They push that into Gerrit. And from there, we'll do the technical checks we've talked about. And if they are right, we are going to publish that to a development site. From there, a peer analyst can actually look at the content. Obviously, you don't want to review the code. It's a very long XML file. I think at the end of this project, I was starting to be able to read that, but no one should.
He did that for a year.
Hard life. The peer analyst just say in the UI, okay, this content looks good to me. And so at the next release, we just send this to production. And so in Gerrit, we put everything. Actually, the analysts, they also manage the project, so they can create projects. They just push a file. And they also define the permission, so who are the people who should access that. The only part on our side is we wanted to be able to audit that and to roll back if there was some kind of very bad mistake done with that. So it works great, except that you cannot manage everything with Git. Again, it was Tableau 9. We actually started rolling out this with Tableau 10.1. And at that time, we couldn't schedule any extract. So we needed a solution for that because we could not put that in Gerrit. We had another issue. Our analysts, they didn't know when the data was available in the table. So they were basically asking to refresh everything every hour. So we actually had some reports that were never refreshed because the backgrounder were completely full of stuff to do. So to fix that, we actually had to come up with an external scheduling. So which hopefully you don't need because hard to manage, but we had to do it for this project. Some key points. So. Actually, it refreshes data when it's available. So in our data pipelines, in our ETL, each time we load a table in Vertica, we are going to add a record in another table saying, I've loaded new data there. The scheduler will get that, and so he will know that he has to schedule. To do that, we had to pass custom SQL. I guess maybe 70% of our workbooks have custom SQL, unfortunately. I think this is a reporting services legacy here.
Yeah, 7 years after that, it's still there.
Yeah, okay. We tried to remove that, but we are not really successful.
I mean, that was SQL first before everyone else.
Yeah. So yeah, we parse the SQL query so we can get the list of tables that a report use, so we can actually know what tables we have to check. Unfortunately, sometimes you don't want to wait for a table, so we had to make this optional. So you can actually opt out from a table. So if you have like a referential data that is refreshed every week, you're not going to wait for it every day. So we just pass by this. What it also does is define priorities. So there is two things. There are critical reports. So when they are ready, we want them to be refreshed as soon as possible. So we have a bunch of them that we can define as the highest priority we can get. All the others, they are going to be executed by execution time. So it's kind of an incentive for analysts to optimize their query, saying like if your query is faster, you're going to be refreshed sooner. And that kind of work, we still have very long query because sometimes you cannot do without that, but it was actually a nice thing to add. And yeah, well, of course, once you've done all the refresh extract, why not just send emails? And this part is actually plugged with Tableau in the sense that we've created a schedule on Tableau, which is called data availability, and it's deactivated, so on Tableau server it does nothing. But then the scheduler gets the list of subscription from there, and it's going to trigger the reports when the data is there. So we don't have in this blank reports been sent by email anymore, which was a lot of the complaints we got by email. This is what it looks like.
This is the best UI we made.
So I guess we are not UX designer again. We are not really good at UI. But you have the list of reports that has been refreshed. You cannot see here, but if there is a failure, you'll see the failure. And if your extract has not been refreshed yet, you can click on it, and this is going to list all the tables it's waiting for. So the analyst, they can go there, like, why is my workbook not updated? They can just go there, look for their workbook, and see which tables they are waiting for. Which is actually important because we have a lot of self-service data. We want self-service for everything, so our analysts can also produce data. And they put that in our vertical cluster, and they can connect their reporting on that. So we needed some control on that aspect. And I guess, so this is a lot of technical tools, so they are nice. They work well. But you cannot actually do that if you don't have a team that's going to manage this community, because we are basically building an internal community of Tableau users. But more than that, we are actually building an analyst community. And so we have an analytics center of excellence, and they are just a bunch of people, so they really needed help with the tooling, because they are managing the self-service data, Tableau, but also we have a Python initiative, so they are managing that as well, training the analysts.
This is a very difficult thing to figure out. That's something we totally stole shamelessly from some Silicon Valley startups. The main idea is those guys are not their bosses. Like, those guys are not the bosses of anyone. They just make sure that everything's coherent, that you can find good documentation. They create a community. For us, it's a big help, because let's imagine that we were, like, what, 6-7 people answering the needs of 200 guys all around the world, 4 o'clock, us only in Paris. I mean, it was a nightmare. We were on pretty much on Slack every day. Before, it was Communicator, but we were on Slack pretty much every day answering requests. And we are no business experts. Like, I mean, there's no way I can tell that a given field in a given report is good or not, and you neither.
And actually, this helped a lot with the rollout, because when we had to train people to this new tool, we couldn't train everyone. So what we did, we actually trained we highly trained some people in all the offices, in all locations. We call them champions. And we delegated the training to other analysts to them. And newcomers as well, because we could not follow up with the number of newcomers we had at that time. So the really key point, having the right guys to take care of that. Because you still need people in the end. It's not just a technical issue. If someone tells you governance is a technical issue, not entirely.
Yet, but not only.
Yeah.
That's the main thing, because we're R&D, we always do technical presentations, and people always think that we have a technical solution to everything. And in this case, no, we don't have a solution to that.
And so we are just going to showcase some actually concrete stuff that this helped us with. The first one was we had an old data mart in Vertica. It was an unoptimized table based on past businesses, so not really relevant to our current business. And we needed to migrate everything to new tables. So we decided to change everything. And we have lineage, so we can have the Tableau catalog before Tableau did it. It's uglier. So we could track for each workbook which table they were using. And we had like a mapping of which table you should use now. And so we were able to actually migrate that in less than a quarter, which was quite amazing for 1,000 dashboards. And I guess we did some cleaning as well.
It's like hundreds of tables, thousands of dashboards.
Yeah. So great job. We had 200 people on that, so they were very efficient. I actually talk about the easy transition. So it's more, we are talking at scale in the title. So if you wonder which scale we are, our Vertica cluster is more than 600 terabytes.
So this is the one that is just Tableau's backend. Like this thing is used for nothing else than Tableau. But so you can guess, this is only SSDs. So you get pretty much guess the price. So that's the kind of thing you do when you have no other option. That's the meaning of the message.
So nice story, when I took the screenshot, I was like, wow, we are low in space.
Yeah.
And it was just before the weekend, so we had to delete some.
Yeah, that's a true screenshot from last Friday where you did some manual cleanup, so that no
we almost had a very bad weekend. And this is the kind of reporting we do. So I think a lot of people, they will get the data from the internal repository, from Tableau, to do their own reporting because the current reporting that Tableau provides, they are kind of limited. So this is one of the examples. And what you see here is something that we have. It's the table and the usage. So we know how many workbooks use which tables, which is really useful for us. Especially when we need to remove data, we can actually just remove tables that are not used in any workbook. And we are sure we are not breaking anything. Another thing that Tableau Catalog is going to provide, apparently, we wanted to give this kind of information to the end user. So the solution we had for that is a web service. We call that Tableau Stickers. And it just provides this kind of widget you can add in a workbook. So it's a URL that you can insert. And it's going to give you the last refresh date, whether it's self-service data or core data. Obviously, self-service data is less reliable than the core data. So you will have more issues coming with this data. And whether it's live or an extract.
It was again, a pragmatic idea to get, because our clients, like the final clients of dashboards are not or direct clients, those are salespersons in the regions, yeah. And those guys never talk to us. Yeah, so we discussed that with Daniel, and we would need some way to communicate with them. Like, those are not our clients. And so they are asking questions like, why is this data late? I don't know. The only guy who knows is the analyst. Maybe he's off. So I would like to push some content in that. And I think that's a really good pattern.
So this is still really early. We didn't actively roll out yet. Now that we are in a newer version of Tableau, because it was for 10.4, I think, we probably would migrate that to an extension, so the integration in Tableau Desktop is easier for the user. So yeah, some follow-up on that. And actually, to conclude, if you want to put in place some kind of things like this, so it's a release process, if you want to embed Tableau, that's probably something you need.
Yeah, I don't know if you saw Matthew Miller's presentation.
This story presentation that was there this morning. They are talking about a release process, so this is one of them, one example. Mm-hmm. So we did everything. We started early. We had almost no resources. Thankfully for you, you now have some resources to get started. And I would advise you to start with what Tableau provides. So the multi-environment, like switching the connection string in a workbook between a Tableau dev and a Tableau server production, you can use the document API. So it's in Python, and that just does that. If you need to use the REST API that we use very heavily, you have a client that is already implemented as well in Python. So
you're suggesting that they go for Python?
Except if you really want to parse SQL, so there is a bunch of examples. The Python one I didn't try, I'm not sure it's really good. Calcite is pretty good, so you could use that, but it's in Java. Mm-hmm. And the last one is in Haskell. Probably shouldn't use that.
Subject to debate, let's say.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And actually, if you really want to do something quick, don't parse the SQL queries. If you just want to get the tables, get all the list of all the tables you have, and just try to find them in the queries. Like just do a find function, and that's all. I think that's fast enough for this use case.
Always duct tape first.
Yeah, it's faster to release. Mm. And so if you have any questions, I think we have time to take one or two questions, actually.